Dit is Papa Alpha 0 Echo Tango Echo voor de Daily Minutes met een nieuwsupdate voor vandaag. Schrikkeldag 29 februari 2016. Ik doe het niet over. Dit is het bulletin van maandag. Ik heb een paar korte zaken en dan komt deel 2 van de Engelstalige serie over cryptografie. Als het met het monteren mee zit, is er aan het eind van de uitzending een SSTV plaatje. De nieuwe CQPA kan momenteel gedownload worden van www.vrza.nl. En verder maakte luisteraar Sjaak me er vandaag op attent dat er een nieuwe Raspberry Pi is en dat ik dat nog niet in de uitzending genoemd heb. Dat heeft te maken met de mindere tijd die ik momenteel voor de uitzending beschikbaar heb. De nieuwe Raspberry 3B heeft onder andere een kloksnelheid van 1,2 GHz in plaats van 900 MHz die de 2B had. En hij heeft net als de 2B ook een quad-core processor. Verder heeft hij een ingebouwde wifi ontvanger en Bluetooth aan boord. En dat is natuurlijk wel leuk. Het nieuwe dingetje kost net boven de 40 euro. Nog steeds geen geld dus. Ja, is verder niet zo heel veel nieuws wat ik even kort kan melden. Of het moet zijn dat er op 13 maart een 80 meter foxhole is in Amersfoort. Maar ja, dat is nog ver weg en meestal meld ik dat vlak voor de tijd. De komende dagen heb ik overigens onverwacht weer wat meer tijd dan ik ingeschat had. Dus waarschijnlijk kan ik dan ook wat meer tijd aan de uitzending besteden. Misschien wel aan wat digitale toevoegingen. Goed, er volgt nu deel 7 van de serie over cryptografie.
You can see things that suggest there was going to be an attack. And if you know, as we now know, that the target was Pearl Harbor, you can easily read into those messages that it was exclusively Pearl Harbor.
Reading the Japanese diplomatic traffic made it clear to U.S. intelligence that Japan was preparing for war, and U.S. forces were on the alert throughout the Pacific. But no one ever imagined that the entire Japanese battle fleet could sail halfway across the Pacific to attack Hawaii without being seen. Most senior U.S. officials believed that the Philippines were the most likely target, but they were wrong.
Since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7th, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
After Pearl Harbor, America was at war, and arms production became the top priority. Though the attack had crippled the Pacific Fleet, the aircraft carriers Enterprise and Lexington were safely at sea when the Japanese attacked. At Pearl, work began immediately to raise and repair the damaged battleships. And away from the dockyards, in underground bunkers, Commander Joe Rochefort and his small team of codebreakers were ordered to attack the vital Japanese fleet code, JN-25, to learn where the next blow would come.
JN-25 was the Japanese Navy's main operational code, whereas the purple machine was a diplomatic cipher used by the Foreign Office and the diplomats. Purple was difficult to solve, but once solved was easier to go along with. On the other hand, JN-25 was a more difficult code to solve, not because of anything inherent in it, but because we had fewer intercepts, therefore less to work on.
JN-25 was a tough code system with over 45,000 groups. The words of the messages were first transposed into five-figure groups. Then, from another code book, random numbers were added to produce the groups that were actually sent. The sender also included a key to enable the receiver to remove the random numbers and get back to the original code. Tommy Dyer, one of Rochefort's key aides, was so short-staffed he was assigned the bandsman from the battleship California, which had been sunk at Pearl, to operate the unit's IBM machines. Everyone worked around the clock to break JN-25. By April 1942, they began to decode almost complete messages, like this one detailing the destroyer escorts for Japanese carriers, and they learned of a major new attack. The Japanese sent the carriers Zuikaku and Shokaku to attack Port Moresby in New Guinea. After Rochefort showed him the messages, Admiral Chester Nimitz sent the Yorktown and Lexington to intercept the Japanese in the Coral Sea, but they failed to make contact. However, on May the 7th, Navy planes searching for the Japanese carriers spotted another force escorting enemy troop ships towards New Guinea. They attacked it, and sank the carrier, the Shoho, in just 10 minutes. The American codebreakers had helped to score a major victory. It was the first Japanese ship's turn back. The next day, both the main carrier forces launched airstrikes. The Japanese carriers escaped with little damage, but the USS Lexington was hit and eventually had to be abandoned. For Nimitz, it was a grievous loss of both men and a major ship. But for the Japanese Navy, the Coral Sea was a disaster. Admiral Yamamoto now knew his only chance of winning the war was to lure the remainder of the U.S. fleet into battle and annihilate it. He prepared the largest Japanese battle fleet ever assembled. Admiral Nimitz was now faced with impossible odds. He had just three active carriers to cover the vast spaces of the Pacific. If he positioned his ships in the wrong place, it would leave Hawaii or the West Coast undefended and might well cost America the war. Long-range reconnaissance aircraft scanned the seas around Hawaii, but Nimitz had to depend on the skill of Rochefort and his code-breaking team at Pearl. In May, the team decoded a message that identified the next Japanese target as AF. But where was AF? In Washington, many believed that the target was the Aleutians, but the Naval Chief of Staff thought the target was Pearl Harbor. Rochefort's team believed it was Midway and suggested a way to confirm their hunch.
Midway Island had no independent water source, and they were dependent entirely on a desalinization plant. And he suggested that if a message could be sent from Midway saying that they're short on water, send a tanker full of fresh water, that might cinch it as to the identification of Midway. So they got Admiral Nimitz's approval for it, called the commanding officer at Midway, told him to send a message in a low-level code that said they needed fresh water. And within 2 days, the Japanese had said, AF has a problem. They're short on water. And that was the proof they needed.
Midway was put on the alert, but many of the Washington naval staff still believed Nimitz was falling into a Japanese trap. The Japanese plan was typically complex. The Aleutians would be attacked as a diversion to draw Nimitz north. 24 hours later, the bulk of the Japanese force would wipe out the U.S. fleet, allowing invasion troops to occupy Midway. Nimitz made a desperate gamble. Acting solely on the intelligence from his codebreakers, he committed his entire carrier fleet to head off the attack on Midway. They took up a position northeast of Midway and sent search planes to locate the Japanese fleet some 200 miles to the west.
Daily Minutes zijn dagelijks om 1900 uur te beluisteren op PI2 NOS en 's ochtends om 10:30. Verder zijn de uitzendingen onder andere te beluisteren op youtube.com/PA0ETE.
Weet je wat ik niet snap? Dat er amateurs zijn die meer amateurbanden willen.
Hoezo dat dan?
Nou, PA0ETE vertelde mij laatst dat toen hij centamateur werd, dat er toen maar 5 amateurbanden onder 30 MHz waren. Alleen 80, 40, 20, 15 en 10 meter.
Tegenwoordig hebben alleen de en amateurs er al 3. Er waren toen trouwens ook nog helemaal geen N-amateurs.
Ja, en dan moet je eens kijken wat er allemaal bijgekomen is. 137 kHz, 472 kHz, 160 meter, 60 meter, 30 meter, 17 meter en 12 meter.
Aan de andere kant is het natuurlijk wel altijd leuk om er weer iets nieuws bij te krijgen.
Tuurlijk.